Well, good morning and welcome, and a warm welcome to you all and those on Zoom. I'm now able to start the service because my wife's actually arrived. So, lovely to see you, darling. Anyway, let's just come together now and quiet ourselves and dedicate this time to the Lord. Let's pray. Lord and Father, we come before you this morning and set this time aside. We thank you for this opportunity to acknowledge all you have done for us, to praise you, and to hear from your word. May your spirit be upon us at this time. In your son's name, amen. Well, I don't know how many of you know that last Monday was Blue Monday, said to be the most depressing day of the year, as we're cold, broke, and guilty for not keeping all our New Year's resolutions. So with that introduction, I feel like I should be going to Reverend I Am Jolly and go, welcome everybody. It's wonderful to see you this morning. But, and it's a really important but the good news and the reason for us coming here this morning, we find in Philippians 3:20. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a saviour from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Through our trials and tribulations on this earth, we still have the eternal hope of being with Jesus. So let's sing our first hymn. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence, my light. Be thou my vision.
Sword for the fight. Be thou my dignity, thou my delight, thou my sole shelter, thou my high tower. Raise thou me heavenward, O power of my power. I can't.
And this morning, the speaker today is Gordon, and there'll be communion at around 12 o'clock. We also have Bible teaching tonight from Jim, which is on 1 Corinthians. During the week, we have the Globe Bible mini-school lectures on Tuesday and Thursday. This year, there's no live streaming for that, so it's to attend, and there's more details of that in the information sheet. Next Sunday, Jim's a speaker at the All Age Service with communion again at around 12, and there's no evening service. The other thing to mention is that following the relaxation in the COVID regulations from tomorrow, we will have tea and coffee being served at next week's All Age Service. I'm not going to comment on that. This will be on similar lines to before Christmas. So we'll have the coffee will be served on the social distance area for it served there. We'll have your colour groups. But we're adding in that we're going to make the cafe available. So if those that want to catch up with somebody or speak to somebody, we can do it in the cafe area under cafe regulations. And we feel that allows us to accommodate everybody, and we'll stop any congestion points with people stopping to talk to each other. It's on the basis that somebody wants to talk to you, of course. But anyway, we'll go through all that again next Sunday. Also, the all the various groups are basically back on this coming week, and all the details of that are in the information sheet, which is, says there's copies at the door if you haven't got your email for that. Okay, I think that's the notices. So before Bobby comes to lead us in prayer, we'd like to worship again and come to worship our Lord Jesus. Singing, bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Let's sing, bless the Lord.
Let's stand together. day.
On that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship your holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. I'll worship your holy name.
Bless the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. Let's bow our head in prayer as we come into the Lord's presence. Heavenly Father, our gracious God, oh, how wonderful you are, Father, the great architect of this universe, that you created everything within it, in the heavens and in the world. We thank you, Father. We come before you this morning and we humble our hearts, Father. And we know, Father, that when we come into this place of fellowship with you, Father, we come drawn close to the throne. This is where we bring all our worries, all our concerns. For we know, Father, that this is the time that burdens can swap shoulders, Father. For your yoke is easy. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for the cross. We know, Father, that as we journey through each week, we do the things we shouldn't do and we don't do the things we should do. But, Father, we know that there's grace and mercy at the foot of the cross where your Son, Jesus, laid down his life. He paid the price. He paid the price for our sins that we may be redeemed and stand forgiven and free of sin through the confession of our sins and faith in the Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father, that we have a Saviour this morning, Father, who once wore that crown of thorns and now wears that crown of glory, Father, that we worship and follow a living Saviour. Oh, thank you, Father, and thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you chose the cross. You chose the cross and that by the spilling of your blood that we are washed. Thank you, Father. Father, I pray, Father, this morning that your Spirit may be upon us, that your Spirit will move among us. And Father, we know that, Father, sometimes we can't find the words to say when we come into your presence, but Father, that the Holy Spirit will intercede for us, Father, and we just let the Spirit come upon us and move on us. We pray, Father, and we thank you for Andrew as he leads this morning. We pray that your Spirit will be upon him. And we pray too for Gordon as he comes to deliver the message, Father. We pray, Father, we'll heal directly from the throne this morning, that your words and message will fill our hearts, Father. We come here hungry, expectant, and we want to learn, Father, to be more like Jesus, to be compassionate, to be available, Father, to love our brothers and sisters, but to love those beyond these four walls, Father. Father, guide us in what we say and we do, that we live lives that glorify and honour you and the things that we do and say. Thank you, Father. We pray for the world, Father. Father, oh, so often the things are happening that worry us, but Father, we know you are in control. You, Father, that we pray, Father, for the families of the victims in Tonga, and we pray also, Father, for the rising tensions in Ukraine, Father, where people are being oppressed. We pray, Father, that your will prevail, Father. We pray for our government, Father, as well. Father, and these are difficult and trying times, but we pray, Father, for those people in positions of authority and power that know you, that, Father, they will be guided by you. And for those who don't know you, Father, we pray for them. We pray for them, Father, because we can never underestimate the power of prayer when we come together in your Son's name, Jesus. Father, we pray for our own community. We remember those, Father, that struggle, Father. Those that are sometimes closer than we think. Father, help us, Father, and through your Spirit, Father, guide us to talk to these people sometimes who are only an arm's length away, and they need our encouragement and they need our prayers. Pray that we will be witnesses for you, Father. Heavenly Father, remember our brothers and sisters who are unable to be here today. Remember our brothers and sisters who are Zooming in today as well, Father. Remember these brothers and sisters who are struggling with the isolation caused by the pandemic, Father, with health issues, with physical and emotional health issues. For those brothers and sisters who still feel the pain of bereavement, for those who are struggling with relationships, Father. Father, we pray that you will move among us today, Father. Move among us, Father, and draw us closer to you in our walk, Father, with the Lord Jesus. We pray, Father, and we pray for all our brothers and sisters, and we commend them to you, Father, as we come before you this morning. We pray and ask all this in your Son's name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Before Marion comes and reads for us from God's Word, and the youngsters go out to Sunday Club, we're going to sing again. It's easy to get down, isn't it, with all that's happening in the world today. So I've really just got to, I'll demask. We've really just got to read that verse from Philippians again. It's a wonderful verse that really allows us to focus on what is to come. Reading it again. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Saviour there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, we have the Lord Jesus Christ. It's why we're here today. So let's sing about that. There's a place where the streets shine, where the glory of the Lamb. There's a way we can go there. We can live there beyond time. And the key words, because of you. Hallelujah. The place where the streets shine.
There's a place. There's a place. Where the streets shine with the glory of the Lamb. There's a way we can go there.
We can live there.
Hallelujah.
Beyond time.
Because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because of your blood. No more suffering, no more tears, no more sin, no more sickness, no injustice, no more death, because of you. Because of you, Lord Jesus, because of your love, because of your blood, all our sins.
is joy everlasting. There is gladness, there is peace. There is wine never flowing. There's a wedding, there's a feast. Because of you, because of you, because of you.
Reading this morning is from 1 James verses 1 to 8. James 1 verses 1 to 8. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations. Greetings. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. That perseverance finishes work so that you be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do.
We've heard from God's word, and it's great that we have God's word for us, the true word, for us to be led. And Gordon will do that very shortly as he unpacks that to us. But just to help us focus in on that time, let's now sing again. Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Before Gordon comes to speak to us, let's sing, Speak, O Lord.
Speak, O Lord, as we truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity. And by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak on, Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
And by grace.
Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see everybody here this morning. Thank you for your prayer, Bobby. It was a lovely prayer. Wasn't that a great prayer? It was a lovely prayer. And your waistcoat is shining like these streets that we sang of, buddy. It's great. So we're continuing with our sermon series in the book of James this morning. Jim introduced the letter 2 weeks ago to us. And what I'm covering today, up to verse 8 of chapter 1, will hopefully build on Jim's opening comments on this particular theme. And the overarching theme of these few verses at the start of this chapter is really the trials of life, particularly as we engage with them as believers, as Christians. Of course, by their very nature, trials make faith difficult. It's hard to walk by faith through difficult times. Indeed, I want to acknowledge right at the start of this talk that some trials can feel so overwhelming that we can barely function as we have to pass through them. It may be the loss of a loved one or the loss of a child. These wounds are not healed quickly, nor are broken hearts easily mended. And if you are someone who has known that kind of extreme suffering, I do not wish to be understood today as trivializing or disrespecting the depth of your pain, the sorrow that you have suffered, as though some clever sermon is all you need to help you move on with your life. No. In fact, and nonetheless, the words of Scripture, as Andrew has been reminding us, are applicable to all of life's experience. That still remains true. And it's my hope for all of us who are suffering in the trials of life at this time that by sharing the scriptures today, there will be something from God for you this morning that will, in the mystery of his ways, bring a measure of hope and comfort and guidance into your life at a time of great difficulty. So this morning, I want to say, in regard to trials, first of all, there are blessings we can anticipate. Despite the awfulness of our trials, there are blessings we can anticipate. Secondly, there is wisdom to help us navigate. Wisdom to help us navigate. And thirdly, there is double-mindedness spoken of that we must eliminate. So firstly, there are blessings we can anticipate as we pass through the trials of life. And that sounds an oxymoron. It sounds an odd combination, but of course, scripturally, it's true. First of all, as we've thought, as Jim reminded us last time, trials are inevitable. Man is born to trouble, the scripture says, as the sparks in a fire fly upwards. They never fall downwards. They always go upwards. We're born to trouble in that sense.
And if, as a Christian, when you became a Christian, you expected your life to be suddenly free of trials, then you were very quickly disappointed with what followed. If we accept that the normal Christian life is full of trials and hardships, some small, most small, but some great, then we are less likely to be caught off guard when trials, when challenges come. Peter, in his first letter, says, don't be surprised by the fiery trials that you are experiencing right now, as though something strange or unusual, abnormal was happening to you. And so if we adjust our expectations, there is blessing from God in that kind of realism about the trials of life. Secondly, our particular trials are allowed and fashioned. I use that word advisedly, fashioned by God. I believe it's true to a huge degree that God fashions our particular trials. And many of our trials come to us because we are living in as fallen people. Yes, as Christians, we are redeemed by the blood of Christ. We have a new creation identity. But we are living in a fallen world. And the world is broken, and in a broken world, bad things happen to good people. However, as Christians, we have a heavenly Father, and he is on the throne of heaven. Not only does he love us immensely, the proof of God's love is the cross of Jesus. God loved the world so much in all our hardship and trials and sorrow and sin that he gave his one and only Son, that by believing in him, we might not perish in this fallen world, but have redemption, salvation, everlasting life. Not only does God love us in such a way, but as he sits on the throne of heaven, he is in control of everything to do with our lives. When trials come, we should not think of them in terms of accidents or fate or karma is a popular word. What goes around comes around to an extent. Yes, what we sow, we shall reap. But this is nothing to do with false religion. Neither should we think in terms of bad luck as having their place in our lives within the will of God. No, God is the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions and sorrows. We should think of trials and difficult seasons in life as having their place, having their day in our lives within the will of God, who loves us, who comforts us, who has given his Son for us. We have to see trials in context. And this God, he promises, will carry us through our trials as we look to him, as we walk with him, as we continue to use that stretched, tired faith to put our hand into his hand. And yet he says he is the potter. God is the potter and we are the clay. And the potter chooses to take the hard times of life to pressurize and to pummel the stubborn clay of our hearts. His desire is only to do us good. Remember that. That's the context. God does us good that he might cause us to depend on him more, to draw us to himself and to shape our lives through that impact of trial that at the time feels so unwelcome. Yet God is in it doing us good, as the potter does good to the clay to shape it and mold it into something beautiful, something useful, something infinitely precious. God is at work through our trials. And there is great blessing and comfort when we remember that no trial comes our way that our Heavenly Father has not permitted. Not permitted. He is the gatekeeper of your trials. And he is totally in control of what he allows us to pass through. And he is working all things together for good, even the painful and the difficult times of sorrow and loss. Thirdly, trials make faith harder, as I said at the beginning, to exercise that faith. But are used of God, trials are used of God to make our faith stronger. Why do so many people these days spend hours in the gym pumping iron? I don't know what it's called. That's what it was when I was young and trying to follow in the footsteps of Arnold Schwarzenegger. You can see it. That's worked well. Pumping iron and jogging on the running machine. Why do they do that? The answer is they want to get stronger and fitter. They want to look good and enjoy better health. And some of us do need to join a gym. You know, that, like, yeah, just go there. Just do that. Get into the gym and join up. But they do that to achieve these outcomes. And they put their body through the trials and exertions and exhaustion of the gym. Now, when we exercise, our muscles become exhausted. They struggle to cope because they are being pushed to the limit. But afterwards, they recover. And of course, what we find is that they become stronger than they were before. Similarly with our faith. God allows circumstances to crash into our lives that stretch our faith to exhaustion. We say, I've no faith left, Lord. I'm weary believing. I can't keep on trusting. With the psalmist, how often did we hear this in the Psalms? How long, oh God, must I endure this misery, this heartache, this pain, this frustration, this trial? But as we seek him, not leaning on our own understanding, as the Bible says, but in all our ways, even in the midst of trial, trying to acknowledge God, put God first. So with the passage of time, we find our faith has become stronger. It's become less easily exhausted. It has become more able to persevere through the next trials that come our way. Indeed, through trials, our faith grows so that we get greater comfort from the gospel. The gospel becomes more and more precious as we pass through the trials of life. We have greater confidence in God's word, and we have greater compassion for God's people. Confidence in God's word, comfort from the gospel, compassion for God's people growing in us, trial by trial, as we walk through the hard times with Jesus. In verse 4 of our passage, James says, let perseverance finish its work. That is the perseverance of our faith as we walk through trials, so that you may be mature, he says, and complete, not lacking anything. Fourthly, another blessing that comes through our trials is that God works in our trials to form us into, or to form in us, the character of Jesus, the character of Jesus. The maturing and completing process that James speaks of in verse 4 was very relevant to the young Christians that he was writing to. For every Christian who's born again needs to begin to grow. The scripture says God wants us to grow into the fullness of the measure of the stature of Christ. What a journey of growth God has in mind for us. God uses the trials of life to refine our character so that we become more like Jesus in our hearts and in our day-to-day lives, blessing and encouraging and serving those around us. Someone has said, Christians are like tea bags. Can you think why Christians are like tea bags? You don't know what flavor they are until they end up in hot water. Well, it's God's will to use the trials of life to fashion Christ in us so that, as Paul says, when we go around our daily, normal, ordinary business, we may spread everywhere the sweet savor of the Lord Jesus, the sweet fragrance of Christ percolates, emanates from our lives because we've walked with Jesus through the trials of life, and God is forming the sweet character of Jesus in our own souls. Another blessing that God brings out of trials, fifthly, trials prepare us for greater service in the work of the Lord. As we grow up through the hardships of life into the image of Jesus, we become equipped and ready to take on greater roles and responsibilities as the children of God, as the servants of the Lord. Trials fashion our maturity and our ability, and they hone our gifting and expand our life experience so that we might serve and bless others, leading them to know Jesus, strengthening their faith, setting a good example of how to behave in life, especially in the tough times, helping others carry their burdens and equipping them to stand with us to serve others. All of this for the glory of God. All these blessings that come from our heartache as Jesus takes us by the hand through the difficult days of our lives. And after a lifetime of trials, and you should read the story of Moses if you need to be refreshed in thinking of that. After a lifetime of trials, Moses was commissioned by God to bring Israel out of Egypt at the tender age of 80. God is maturing you through your trials for his work in this world. And the last aspect of blessing through trials I want to mention this morning is sixthly, that trials fit us for heaven. Trials fit us for heaven. Hallelujah. It is a great blessing what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, that our momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal weight of glory. Paul says that in comparison to the glory that will somehow be revealed in us, what is God doing? He's forming Christ in us. Christ in us. And one day he will take the scaffolding down and the curtains will come back, and this mortality that has feet of clay will be transformed into the likeness of his glorious body. And in that moment, somehow out of our being, out of the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, out of the blood he shed and the horrors he suffered, there will be to God the Father in that moment that incomparable glory that radiates from the church of Jesus Christ and the redeemed of the Lord in that moment, having passed through the valley of sorrows and trials and heartache. In that moment, we will declare, hallelujah, Father, it has all been worth it. For look at the glory that is radiating through us, that the whole universe, this is God's plan, the whole created order would see the glory of God in the church of Jesus Christ. That's where we're going. That's the blessing that's there for us. And we can understand, therefore, without it sounding glib or insensitive, without you feeling misunderstood and patronized, why James, in the light of these blessings, says, count it all joy, joy, when you face trials of many kinds. So there are blessings we can anticipate. Secondly, through the trials of life, there is wisdom to help us navigate. Wisdom to help us navigate. James says, verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Let's remind ourselves of the context of this passage. James is encouraging his readers not to give up their faith in Jesus and turn away from their commitment to follow Christ. James says to them, don't give up. What you need is a better perspective on the trials that you face. What you need is wisdom from God. You see, wisdom enables us to see the painful seasons in life through the eyes of the Almighty. Isn't it the case that when trials come, we say things like, why is this happening? How am I meant to keep going? Where is God when you need him? What if I do pray? What difference will it make? What am I supposed to pray? And where am I going to end up if there's no answer to this problem, this trouble? So in the midst of trials, it quickly becomes clear that what we need is wisdom. Wisdom to answer all our questions. Remember, trials must come. No one is exempt. So the great challenge for us as Christians is to handle trials wisely. To handle trials wisely. We see in verse 5, five encouragements to pray for wisdom. James says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Notice, first of all, it says God gives wisdom to all, to everyone, so that no matter who you are here this morning, God is willing to give you his wisdom in order to help you navigate wisely through the trials of life. Secondly, notice it says God gives wisdom generously. This means that in every trial, on every occasion where you feel at a loss, where you don't know how to cope, you can ask God and he will give you more wisdom to help your situation. Now, here is the wonderful thing about wisdom, because you're maybe saying, well, it's great to have God's wisdom. Thank you, God, for wisdom. But what I really need is something that changes the situation, something that helps practically or spiritually or emotionally in the situation that I'm not going under, but I'm starting to come back up. And here is the wonderful thing about the wisdom of God, because later in chapter 3 of his letter, James says, the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. This means that the wisdom God gives us is full of many exceptional qualities that you will need in order to navigate your way faithfully and successfully through the trials that you face. For with the wisdom that comes from heaven, God will help you, what did we hear? Stay pure. There's purity in the wisdom of God. He will give you peace. There's peace that comes to touch our lives as God gives us wisdom. He'll keep you considerate towards others when you want to shout people down and scream at those that have hurt you, perhaps, to take vengeance. He'll keep you in that place of humility and being gracious to turn the other cheek when you feel that lashing out and getting your own back. He'll help you to remain submissive. The wisdom from God brings submission to his lordship. That's the best place for us to be. In the place at the foot of Jesus, as we thought earlier, in submission to Christ, currying in at the foot of the cross. He'll keep you in his mercy. Wisdom from God brings mercy to your situation, where your heart is raging within you. Your mind is a kind of cauldron of anger and frustration and sadness and all of that. There's mercy, mercy. God will keep you. He'll watch you. He will not condemn you. He will treat you with mercy as his wisdom comes to you. And he'll help you to keep on doing good. He'll keep you on the right path. The wisdom of God enables you to fulfill your good duties and responsibilities as a Christian before him, because your Father is watching how you maintain your poise, your dignity, your obedience, your faithful service, particularly at those times when life just feels so impossible. And we want to, like the young Christians that James is writing to, we want to pull back, opt out, turn away. James says, no, there is wisdom from God that is unspeakably wonderful for all of us, for all of us. Thirdly, notice that God does all this, the verse says, without finding fault with the one who's asking. There's no condemnation. God does not condemn you for struggling in your trials. He doesn't judge you for needing to come to him time and time again. Our Father delights to shower good things upon us when we turn to him for wisdom in the midst of our trials. Notice fourthly that when we ask for wisdom, it will certainly be given to us. God will not deny that request. From this verse, we see that God has committed himself to always answer our prayer for wisdom and not to withhold it from us. And as we've seen, what wonderful, life-changing, enabling wisdom God has for us in our time of trial. And so fifthly, it's clear that God fills our lack of wisdom, our lack of ability to remain pure, our lack of ability to know how to compose ourselves, to act with dignity and poise in the midst of trouble, how to remain faithful to God and loving towards others when in our hearts things are so difficult. God fills our lack of wisdom with his wonderful divine wisdom that keeps us moving forward in the day of trouble to his glory, to his honor. And so this wisdom helps us navigate our way through the trials of life. The song that I'm sure we know by Andre Crouch says, I've had many tears and sorrows. Maybe this is your song. Maybe Blue Monday is not a joke in your life. Andre Crouch sang, I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. There's been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation that my trials may come only to make me strong. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. So we've seen that through even the most severe trials, firstly, there are blessings we can anticipate. And secondly, there is wisdom to help us navigate. And finally, thirdly, there is double-mindedness. James says we must eliminate. In verses 6 to 8, we read, but when you ask for wisdom, that is, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. Now, in these verses, James is talking about something that is a bit more serious than the honest doubt of the committed Christian. Remember the man who came down the mountain and said, Lord, my son is sick, I believe, help my unbelief. Now, that was honest doubt. He was using his faith. He was using what faith he had. Jesus did not condemn him. And Jesus responded to that faith. James is talking here about something more serious, more deep and concerning. And the key to understanding the root of this problem lies in the phrase, a double-minded person is unstable in all they do. Double-mindedness, as it appears in the Greek sentence here, literally translates as the one who has two souls. The one who has two souls. And what we understand by that is that here is someone who will not give up the things of earth, yet is trying to grasp after the blessings of heaven. Here is someone who claims to follow Christ, but is not committed to true discipleship. For it's as though they have two souls, one which is following Christ and one which is caught up in the things and the goals, the ambitions, the pleasures of this world. So this may be someone who looks and sounds like a committed Christian, but they are not that committed beneath the surface. God knows their heart, and beneath an outward form of godliness, there is a worldliness and a self-serving spirit within. So James says a person should not expect to receive anything from God who is like that, for they only call upon the Lord when they need God to get out of trouble. They're only looking to God when it's absolutely necessary. He says the double-minded, the double-souled person is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. First of all, James says that like a wave, such people are constantly restless, constantly on the move. They know no peace, for they have not found satisfaction by feeding on the things of Christ. Their appetites are the appetites of the world. The scripture says there is no rest granted to the wicked. Secondly, James says that like a wave of the sea, such people are unstable. They are unstable in the things of Christ. They blow hot and cold. They will be unreliable as partners in the gospel. Their lifestyle will not be a consistent witness for Christ, and they will not take their responsibilities seriously in the life of the church. Thirdly, James says that like a wave, they are driven by the wind. That is, they are driven perhaps by the wind of doctrine and emotional experience. They are inconsistent and seemingly unable to take a firm stand on Christ and upon the promises of God. And fourthly, it's clear that like a wave of the sea, they are capable of great destruction within the body of Christ. But the concerning aspect of this is that to different degrees, at different times in our lives, we all have the capacity for aspects of double-minded living. Let me encourage you, as of today, to seek to eliminate all double-mindedness from your life in regard to the things of Christ. Therefore, as we need to, as we examine our hearts, let us confess our sins to God and ask him to search us and see if there be any evil way in us. And with confession and with repentance, let us turn back to Christ, whose death on the cross is able not only to cleanse us from all sin, but to deliver us from getting stuck in double-minded living, when Jesus calls us to always seek first the things of the kingdom of God. As James says, let us be doers of these things and not hearers only. So then, as we conclude, we've seen this morning that in regard to the trials of life, firstly, there are blessings God wants us to anticipate. Secondly, there is this amazing wisdom to help us navigate. And thirdly, there is double-mindedness that lurks seeking to infiltrate all of our hearts and lives, which we must eliminate. I close with this little poem called Out of the Darkness. Very simple. Out of the dark, forbidding soil, the pure white lily grows. Out of the black and murky clouds descends the stainless snow. Out of the crawling earth-bound worm, a butterfly is born. Out of the somber, shrouded night, behold, a glorious morn. Out of the pain and stress of life, the peace of God pours down. Out of the nails, the spear, the cross, redemption, and a crown. Father, thank you for the writings of the book of James. It's so practical. It's so helpful. It's so necessary. And we just surrender ourselves at the foot of the cross of Jesus. Whatever burdens we're carrying, as Bobby reminded us at that place, burdens can swap shoulders. What a great thought. Oh, Lord, we lay our burdens down at your feet, saying, Father, have your way in our lives. Let it be all for your glory, all for your pleasure, for you are good. And we trust you this morning through faith in Jesus' name. Amen.
Gordon spoke of glory. That glory of Jesus, the glory when we will see Jesus again. Let's sing our final hymn. And let's celebrate that fact. Let's sing the song, I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing, Hosanna, Hosanna. Let's think on that day. Let's think on that celebration, singing, I see the King of Glory.
Glory coming on the clouds with fire.
Service. Communion will probably be about 5 to 12, I would think. And if we just close in prayer. Lord, we thank you. We thank you so much for that eternal hope that you've given us. We thank you that one day we will see Jesus face to face. Lord, help us just to remember this as we go through the trials and tribulations of life, Lord, that there is that waiting for us, that time, Lord. Let us show that excitement through us, Lord. And as we go out through this week, may those that we meet see that eternal hope in us and ask, what have they got that I haven't, that they might be drawn to you, Lord? Oh, we pray that the folk of this town are drawn to you. We just ask this in your Son's name. Amen.